Good afternoon,
Good afternoon,
everyone. Thank you, Dr. Paul Rabe, for inviting me to this Urban Knowledge Network Asia presentation series and also for introducing me today. I would also like to thank Urban Studies Foundation Glasgow and IEAS Leiden for hosting me again. As Dr. Rabe mentioned, I have worked on gender, sexuality, and caste in media studies in the context of India in most of my previous works. I'm trained in cultural studies as a scholar. So my approach to urban geography is also informed by my training in critical cultural studies. So I'll start today's presentation with an incident. In 1982, a fisherman noticed a shipwreck at Midge Bay in North Island of New Zealand, and he alerted it to some of the employees at the local Maritime National Museum, who started investigating the salvaged timbers some years later. And they found that these timbers were made of teak and lagerstromia. And some of the scientists concluded from the carbon dating study that this ship could have been built by the Dutch East India Company, probably in Batavia in the early 1700s. But there were some critics who said that this may not have been built in Batavia, though that was their biggest ship building yard in Asia. So for instance, Dutch maritime historian Erik Odehard, in his article Building Ship at the VOC Yard in Cochin, says that Cochin has been a very active shipyard during the time of the Dutch, where several small vessels were built as well as big vessels were brought for repair and so on. So shipbuilding has been a continuous thread in Kochi's evolution from the times of colonizers and even before. So even after independence, this tradition, shipbuilding tradition, continues in other ways. We'll come to that very soon. So to locate Kochi, one can spot Kochi in this map on the bottom left. It is the third name. That is the southwest of the Indian subcontinent. So because of its open shores and availability of spices and so on, Kochi had a long tradition of trade with Chinese, Arabs, Romans, and so on, and later all colonizers like Portuguese, Dutch, and British also made Kochi their base for some time. So because of this intermingling and interactions in the form of trade, colonization, and missionary activities, social theorist Ashish Nandi notes that Kochi is probably emotionally closer to Southeast Asia, East Africa, and West Asia culturally, probably more than to several other parts of the Indian subcontinent. So as is the case with several other port cities, the enterprises along the shores were central to the development of Kochi after independence. As I mentioned, Cochin Shipyard was one of the major projects sanctioned in Kochi after independence of India by Jawaharlal Nehru in the 1950s itself. So this shipbuilding tradition of Cochin continued with the construction of the modern yard, and it was inaugurated, though it was sanctioned in the 50s, it was inaugurated by Indira Gandhi in 1972, almost two decades later. So the shipbuilding remains as a continuous thread from Cochin's historical time to its post-independence development initiatives. So these continuities reflect not just in built structures and development projects, but also among the people who dwell in the city. Then how would one understand a connected making of the built environment of Kochi and the people who live in the city, both of which are informed by the merging of cultures from its historical past to the present? A built environment is central to the making of the city, so much so that it is often identified as one of the distinguishing features of every city. The built environment does not need to be viewed linearly as inert buildings, but it merges with the people in the city. Greek cultural anthropologist Nadia Sarametakis notes that these structures live through a rhythm and flow by acquiring meanings and lives in relation to the people who inhabit these spaces. This is especially becoming clearer in these times when public spaces look deserted and desolate because of the lockdowns due to the coronavirus pandemic last year. So the life of the city is complementary to how citizens inhabit those spaces. In other words, urban spaces acquire meanings from how they are embodied by people as well. If cities are embodied, then any study of urban space would be a study of not just their structures, but their people as well. So my project captures this embodied urban geography of Kochi by analyzing its post-independence development initiatives, as well as its representative and artistic practices. Kochi's urbanity is conceived herein as an amalgam of its history, post-independence structures, people, and imagery about the city. So to do this connected reading of structures and people, as well as the real and the imagined city, this project is divided into two major thematic parts. The first part, consisting of three chapters, discusses the major development projects that took off on the shores of Kochi in the 20th century. These chapters provide an account of people and communities involved in these projects and what it entailed for spaces and the people of Kochi. This approach is informed by emerging studies on cities which understand them as living spaces of varied effects and meanings. The second part elaborates on the imagined city of Kochi as the boundaries of the real and the imagined are seamless, especially more so in a mediated world. The three chapters in this part elaborates how Kochi is imagined through various artistic practices, representations, and literature. In this presentation today, I'll discuss some sections from both these parts. I raise some questions about studying urban space making as much as an intangible and affective experience of displacement, religion, and embodied geographies using interdisciplinary methods. In the first section of this presentation, I'll discuss the debate surrounding the construction of the Cochin Shipyard Limited, the despair and the inevitable eviction of communities from the shores for the construction of the new yard in the 1960s, the promise of development, employment, and the continuing imaginary threats of displacement of the other are some themes of this section. In the second section, I analyze cinema to foreground a connected making of the cinematic geography of the city and development of urban space in tandem with wider socio-economic changes. So to start with the shipyard, as I mentioned earlier, the first shipyard was sanctioned in the 1950s, late 50s, by the first Indian government after independence. So it was in line with this ideas of nationalistic development, which the first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru followed in developing the country. So he had this vision of building modern institutions and public sector companies for developing the country. And his vision is evident in one of his speeches while he was inaugurating a big dam called Bhakranangal Dam. He even compared these institutions and these dams to as equivalent to a place of worship, such as a temple or a gurudwara or a mosque. So there was this attempt to kind of think about development as the spiritual material aspiration, spiritual and material aspiration to look forward to. But however, in the Indian story of modernity, religion took a different turn, which we are witnessing today. So this project was also in line with this Nehruvian idea of development. And today, Cochin Shipyard is one of the one among the most successful public sector undertakings, and it is the biggest shipyard in India today. However, its establishment was entangled with the encounter between religion, state, caste, and development. So though it was sanctioned in 51, as I mentioned earlier, it took almost two decades to complete the construction of the shipyard. So this was due to several reasons. However, one of the reasons was that this land, which was earmarked for the construction, was occupied by about 200 families, and there was also an old church that was part of this land. So the
So we have a slight technical hiccup. I think we lost the connection with Dr. Carmel Christie, but she is logging in again. So please just bear with us and give us a few moments while she logs in again.
Sorry, so we were talking about how these conversations were happening about leaving this land and to construct Cochin Shipyard. So one of their concerns was the loss of livelihood, and of course the second concern was there was also a cemetery attached to this church, which was to be dismantled. And since most of this community members were also not an educated group, one way of making sense of a certain historicity or making sense of their past was through this cemetery, that their forefathers were buried there. So there was a certain sense of history that this cemetery has managed to give for this community. So, and most of these community members didn't own any land in this place, so they haven't had any ownership over the land. So basically, there were no documents which were kind of which proves their history or which shows their continuity of living in this space or marking their presence in this planet. So in that way, the cemetery was more than a spiritual or religious symbol. It was also part of a certain history for these communities. However, as finally they agreed to leave, and since part leaving the cemetery was part of, it was like losing a part of their past, one of the ways in which they came to terms with it was by digging the land up to 6 feet down and transferring all that soil into the new cemetery. And they considered it as taking their forefathers' remains with them to keep continuity with their new life in another place. The place and the soil was essential for them to go on living with their past. Cletus, one of the occupants of this land, Perumanoor, distinctly remembers that they had stopped burying bodies at the cemetery 6 months before they transferred the remains to the new place. The place they finally managed to shift to is now marked as a working class colony in the heart of the newly organized city. Spatially, they occupy a part of the city, but that space was stigmatized by their own occupancy. Spatial arrangement of the city therefore holds within itself memories and lived experiences of the material and cultural development communities underwent in relation to their religious and caste lives. So now we go into the next section where the Cochin shipyard already started its operations. The land where the cemetery stood was being rebuilt into a dock. A dock is a space where you can contain and retain water for the ships to enter and be repaired. And when this construction of the dock was happening, several stories started circulating about this place where the cemetery stood and the dock was being built. So the afterlife of this cemetery began in the form of myths and stories. Though there are no official remembrance or official records of this eviction and so on, but the stories started circulating. Literature, stories, and myths reveal what formal histories cannot always offer, sometimes a leap beyond the recognized reason and logic, a disposition that accommodates the unexplainable excess of human lives. I tap into such sorts of literature and myths to understand the interface between the cemetery that symbolizes the religious belonging of a community and shipyard, which stands for a modern promise of progress. So I show one excerpt from a story that mentions this transition of the cemetery into the new dock. So I'll read out this part. I was the team leader of the construction activities of the new shipyard. Dry dock was to be built in a suburb that included a cemetery. Wooden crosses that bore the round letters, "Rest in Peace," were covered by wild creepers. Our team cleaned all that expansive piece of land. We uprooted colonies of wild creepers. We cut down the wild trees, destroyed the gravestones. We removed the remains of foul-smelling dead bodies from their graves. The moist wind from the Arabian Sea swallowed the stench and flew away. So the form and content of the story is laid out in such a manner to create an ambience of a wild grave that was tamed by force. The grave seems abandoned and ready to be cleared. The ritualistic presence of the forefathers' remains in the grave in the earlier section can be contrasted with how they become decayed bodies in the story. While the grave symbolized the continuity of life to the earlier occupants, the aspiration for progress is depicted as made possible through a deliberate discontinuity and othering of that space. The transformation of the land of the people to the abandoned land of the space may be read as how this space had to be reshaped from the space of the unknown wild into the familiar by forcibly taming it. The story narrates how the ghosts were angered at being removed from the graves and attacked the driver. So the story goes on to give more gruesome details about the acts of ghosts and so on. So the transition from a religious site to a modern space hosting sophisticated technology to repair and make ships was riddled with ruptures as well as continuities. Rupture of the aura of that space is sacred into something that marks modernity and progress in development linguistics. This was not a smooth break. The grave returns as a wild presence to be feared, even amidst all technology and machines that epitomize the successful achievements of the newly independent country. The ghost analogizes the past life of the space, which seemed to haunt the present. The new modern life of the space is made possible through a continuity of the othering of the unknown native as ghosts. The fear of the ghost is about the fear of the unknown other, who in this case is the relocated native. The story reveals how displacement and unfinished management of the other in the creation of a modern space is haunted by the unspoken fears of the project of modernity. The writer recounts in his conversation with me in April 2019 that he penned the story based on a real-life accident in the dock and the conversations he overheard while traveling back to his home in southern Kerala by train in the 1970s. So even after several decades of eviction, the cemetery remained as a wild presence within the shipyard, though any new entrants hardly knew the earlier residents of that space, as the writer remembers. So the occupants were not familiar, or who used to live there, that story was not familiar, but the story of the cemetery somehow circulated among the new workers or new people of Cochin Shipyard. So the evicted shore communities, they started living in another part of the city, which is about 3 kilometers from the new Cochin Shipyard, and with all the development that happened thereafter, this part of the city where they live is also quite close to the center of the city. However, due to the lack of economic and cultural mobility, there are several families within this small piece of land, and this new locality is also known by the name Shipyard Colony. And this word colony is used in the current socio-cultural discourse in Kerala with a degrading connotation to refer to the clustered houses offered by the government to landless lower caste communities. So thus, in the heart of the city of Kochi, there is another working class colony of the former shore dwellers who, despite their displacement away from the littoral, are still peripheral to the city's existence. City space is saturated with meanings of social relations and hierarchies, despite its centrality in the geographical map. This also highlights the need to analyze the city as a geographical space produced, experienced, and perceived through social relations and connections, as well as physical fabric and infrastructure. Some of the previous inhabitants of Perumbanoor, when asked about their displacement, remembered their land more vividly as lush green land with coconut trees, mango trees, jackfruit trees, and lives as intricately woven with rituals related to the shores. This contrasts with their new settlement, where there are hardly any trees, as there is not enough space for a tree to grow in the congested premises. They also did not possess ownership in the new land for almost 3 decades, not until 1993. So a new form of tenancy persisted despite their transition to the mainland of the city. Nevertheless, their lives and conversations are also about the promise of change, as many of them are today associated with the shipyard as manual laborers. Even otherwise, they say that the tallest crane that bears the name of the Cochin Shipyard, which they can see from their houses, reminds them of belonging in a place and a shore they never owned, and a new life in the heart of the city where they have been attempting to cultivate belonging. So this was the first ship that was made in Cochin Shipyard, and it was ready by 1981. Now, these are some screenshots from some of the Malayalam films, and one can see the cranes of the shipyard and port in the background. Is it possible to weave a story of the city from these cinematic visuals? Do these visuals represent a slice of urban culture and history of Kochi? If yes, what are the possible ways of knitting together a narrative of development, geography, urban space making, and cinema? So in this section, I tied together these various threads through a connected reading of cinema, city, and geography. Cinema has been identified as a resourceful site to understand the connected history of the city and the socio-economic context. Film studies scholar Edward Dimmenberg, in his book Film Noir and the Spaces of Modernity, demonstrates the connected history of film noir and the growth of modern urban planning from 1940 to 1959. Similarly, Richard Koeck and Leigh Roberts, in their book The City and the Moving Image, explain this framework further by reiterating the need to see in film not only as a genre-dependent text, but also as a rich map of socio-cultural, political, and of course, architectural discourses. Charlotte Brunsden notes that cinema is increasingly understood as a technology of place, as a medium able to produce spatiality through a set of creative tasks, namely location, filming, mise-en-scene, framing, lighting, and editing, unquote. So cinema as a medium is always set in a spatiality, be it indoors such as home, office, outdoors, forest, and so on. So this part of the presentation traces the evolution of human spatiality by capturing the socio-economic context of Malayalam cinema. Malayalam is the language spoken in Kerala, where Kochi is located. A contextual analysis of cinematic frames and effects they evoke leads the author to identify three distinct cinematic geographies of Kochi in Malayalam cinema. So we'll go through some of the screenshots of some Malayalam films to understand how I identify these three cinematic geographies through an analysis of these Malayalam films. So the parts that one see here, the part indicated by A, has several regions named as Fort Kochi, Mattanchery, Chellanam, and so on. And Fort Kochi was the center of a lot of colonial activities. Fort was located here. There are also several cemeteries which contain the remains of several colonial officers and so on. And it is also has a lot of myths of people from different communities, different places, and so on. And this section also has considerable number of religious minorities, including Christians and Muslims. So this part recently is also pitched as a touristic destination because of its historical past and so on. However, it was not an active business space, though Kochi was developing rapidly. So this is what I mark as A. Then the part that is marked as B, this is where the most of the commercial activities in the city take place. So this is even people even describe it as the economic capital of Kerala and the economic nerve of the city of Kochi and so on. And the region marked as C is a cluster of islands in the backwaters. And this part is also marked by majority of shore communities, including Christians, Dalits, and other fisher communities, and so on. And this part has also been has been an active center of different colonial administrations. For instance, one of the I think oldest ports, European forts, Pallippuram Fort is located in this part, and there is also this palace, Bolgatti Palace, which was built by the Dutch, is a tourist attraction today, and so on. However, in the post-colonial period after independence, this part was largely neglected in terms of development projects and so on. And the only form of transport to these places till 2004 was by boats. Only in 2004 these bridges called Goshri bridges were built from the mainland to the islands. So these are the three parts that I have identified by analyzing some of the Malayalam films. So what I will present here is a very brief part to just give a sense of how I arrive at this identification. So these islands, one more thing, that this geographical formation of this part of the city was very important in the way how the port came to existence here. For instance, the port in Kochi was located almost 16 miles north north to the current port. The current port maybe or will be its location is almost here. So, but this is a relatively new port which was established. Of course, the current modern port was built in early 20th century, but the earlier port in Mattanchery emerged in the 14th century. So before that, the port was in a different location. So even this port emerges, according to historians, as a result of a flood in 1341. And as a result of this flood, these islands came up, and through this channel, the ships could enter. A natural port emerged in this part as a result of this flood. So this geographical formation has been very important in the development of the city. So how does these spaces figure in Malayalam cinema? So city spaces have been present or absent in cinema. So however, this city, village, this binary has always been part of cinema in some ways. I am not going into those details, but some of the films in which the city is visible, how do they visibilize city? That is something we'll discuss. So these films, some of these films from the 80s, these are shorts from some of the song sequences in these films. And one can see it's always in the background of backwaters and so on. So in these films, the cinema took on the nature of a tourist to these ports. These were places briefly visited by protagonists in this plot. The sequences were shot in brighter colors and white shorts to reveal the beauty of this space in films. One can see most of them are white shorts. The song sequence, like in this film, shows the romantic past in colorful shorts in the backdrop of the backwaters and ship harbored in the distance. So especially after this song, this hero dies in an accident and so on. And this is a common thread even in the other film, that protagonists come to the city, they have some happy time in the anonymity of the city. And this, these song sequences are replete with scenes of couple embarking on a joyride in the backwaters with the Kochi skyline in the backdrop and the islands at a distance. The crisp editing and fast-moving shots ensure vibrancy to the plot. In contrast to this, one of the main reasons for this part of the city to get into the mainstream media narrative is for its lack of drinking water facilities and the lack of infrastructural facilities. So like I mentioned earlier, the part C, there used to be issues of flooding, water shortage, and so on. And especially in 1982, there was this incident where there was an infamous Hooch tragedy in which 77 people died. 63 were blinded and 15 crippled after they consumed spurious liquor sold by a government authorized liquor shop. So these are the kind of news stories that was appearing about this space that is marked as C. But in the films, they look like this, these beautiful spots. So there was a film made on this Hooch tragedy as well, but in that cinema, that was made in 1982. But this film doesn't really foreground the spatiality the way the later films kind of foreground the spatiality of Kochi. So there is something happening about the spaces generally in the imagination of the generally in the national imagination as well as in cinema. We'll come to that soon. So even in the earlier, even in these films that we just saw, these screenshots, the city beyond the mainland was a touristic addition to the existence of the city. In this sense, there was a certain disembodied geography of this region, which added allure to the exploration of the city for its protagonists. These protagonists always come from somewhere else, and there is a non-urban milieu in which their life is otherwise located. They are coming to the city and they spend some time here. So these islands were not the beneficiaries of the post-colonial development schemes, and the politically and geographically backward population remained disconnected from the mainland till those bridges were built in 2004. So the islands, which are geographically significant for the development of the port, were socially produced as an underdeveloped area lacking basic facilities such as hospitals, higher educational institutions, and so on. And the population of the islands did not figure in these beautiful, colorful visuals of Kochi in the 1980s Malayalam cinema, except as distant greenery during joyrides in the backwaters. So as I mentioned earlier, all these characters come to the city and live their life in anonymity, and they are happy and lively in these sequences. Then the another film which is titled Migratory Birds Do Not Cry itself alludes to the protagonist's migration to the city and the temporary nature in the urban milieu. So as I mentioned, in both these films, the characters die very soon after these sequences. So the city's allure doesn't seem to last long in these films. City offers a fleeting moment of glitter before life ends. This captures the socio-political moment of the 80s, in which the nation was thinking beyond agriculture-based economy. The Gandhian imagination about village-based development and Nehru's nationalistic development were losing sheen, and the country was on the verge of adopting liberalization policies. The idealistic national moral ethic was extending beyond the village. The city was becoming more than the gray undertones in popular representations vis-a-vis the village. So the 1980s were the crossing time of this gradual shift, when the city was beginning to be considered as a placement of movement and vibrancy, yet a place to be cautious about. One noticeable aspect in both the movies is that the characters come to the city and dwell for some time before they die in the city. And there is a non-urban milieu where their life is set otherwise, and the city is a place where they visit. City seems like a place to go to, as if it is out there, away from one's own place and people who live in the city, the people who live in the city are in the background or not visible. So the citizen is located elsewhere, and the city is a passing space as their life fades. And this, the citizen started appearing in Malayalam cinema more clearly from the 1990s. This particular screenshot shows an urban residential locality in Kochi, which is named as Girinagar Residential Colony. So Girinagar Residential Colony was built in the 1960s, and it was one among the first residential colonies in Kerala. So like this, there are several localities of the city that is coming into the frame since the 1990s, unlike the 80s, which was mostly those, you know, main street and the backwaters, the main park and so on. So especially this park they are running into, this is locally known as Mammootty Park, after one of the Malayalam actors' names. He used to live in this park earlier. So now this is a frequent meeting place of the four friends in the film. Several local and city markers of urban planning form the backdrop against which the plot moves forward. And this film introduces more specific urban localities into the urban imagery of Kochi than the earlier films, in which the city was synonymous with Subhash Park and other areas which we saw earlier. So all the local spots in the movie are specifically middle class spaces, and the characters also belong to the same class. All the four heroes do not seem to be working, but just hanging out, riding their bikes and teasing young women in public places. They are shown as young urban men enjoying life, and at the end, they are left with a suitcase full of money. They seem to follow joyful pursuits of life in the colorful version in Kochi. There is one more film which I analyze, which I'll skip today, which also shows this character who is in control of the city and who has access to the best part of the city and so on. So the central part of the city in the cinematic frame is associated with individuals who are not bound by their religious identities, but also entitled and aspirational to immerse themselves in the joys of the city. In contrast to this, Malayalam films set in the islands and Fort Kochi, that is regions A and C, socially produces the region by etching out religious identities. This film called A Name Resulum, was made in 2013. It narrates the tragic love story of Anna from one of the islands called Waipim and Rasul, who is from Matanjeri, who is from the region Magdas A. So this film is remarkable for the manner in which it captures the geography of these islands and its connection to the mainland through the metaphors of boat journeys. Vibrant visuals of church festivals and lower middle class life of Christian shore communities in the islands, Muslim characters in the lower class milieu of Matanjeri, etc., create a well-crafted blend of people and place in the film. Though a love story, the film captures the flow of people from the islands to the city for work, shopping, and almost everything. Geography, context, and human existence complement each other through the visuals, editing, background score, and other technicalities. Anna, the main protagonist, travels in a boat to her workplace in the city every day with her friends. The alternating disconnect with and link to the city, the differences and similarities of both geographies are brought out through boat journeys to and from the city in the backwaters. Cinematic frames capture Anna and her family's life at home as dull and gloomy. She, her family is against her wishes to get married to Rasul, and she ends up committing suicide because she couldn't unite with Rasul. So, in some of these films, which is set in these islands, the heroine, especially in this film, and there is this other film which I analyze, this heroine doesn't from the island does not outlive their cinematic climax. We'll go on to the next film, which is set in the part A, that is Fort Kochi. So this film is, it was a box office hit. It revolves around the story of Vasco, a small-time goon and his friends who idle away time by drinking and fighting. And the central characters in the plot live in a lower class colony, and most members of the group, including this hero Vasco, looks like belonging to Christian shore communities from cultural markers such as these Portuguese origin names and their social background in the film and so on. So the geographical context of this part of the city is established from the beginning of the movie with an aerial shot of Fort Kochi with the Arabian Sea on its west. The voiceover with this shot, presumably that of the main protagonist Vasco, says that he grew up in the city with the wind blowing from the west. The proximity to the sea and a life woven in the context of possibilities and cultural associations related to it keep recurring in the movie. In one of the scenes at Vasco's father's street cafe, his younger sister jokingly tells her elder sister, making fun of a man who keeps on ordering more food and eating at the shop, I quote, "Is his stomach the Arabian Sea?" unquote. There are numerous visuals of ships docked in the background, while the four friends frequently meet to plan their next move, whether it is to pay someone, bribe someone in the hope that they would find some job, or just to hang out. Even amidst their dire economic and social situation, the image of ships, both moving in the sea and in the dock, remains as a sign of possible movement and hope. The cinematic exploration of the same community members, that is Anna in the previous film, and Vasco in this, showed them to be differing in their aspirations and choices. Anna, the silent woman protagonist from Waipim, from the islands in the previous film, is a huge contrast to the always upbeat male hero, Vasco from Fort Kochi in this film. Cinematic geography created by technology of place, including all the technical faculties used to create spatial dynamics, is constituted through gender as much as religion and space. So in these films, the central characters, that especially the films that are set in the part A and C, the central characters are natives who grew up in these places, and their social background is very well etched out. They are not just engaged in the individualistic pursuits in the city, which vents a dream of total freedom for the individual, but their communities get woven into the cinematic regions of Fort Kochi and the islands, unlike the central part of the city and its main protagonist. The geographic dynamics of these regions in the cinematic visuals are marked by religion and gender identities of their characters. Spatiality and religious community are bound together in the cinematic imagination of Fort Kochi and the islands at different levels, while the central part of the city is imagined differently. This foregrounding of diverse urban geography of Kochi in Malayalam cinema created an embodied cinematic geography informed by already existing narratives about these spaces. All these spaces and their people indeed exceed these emerging cinematic representations. For instance, the people who were displaced for the Cochin shipyard must be living in and around here. So, but the visuals of this part of the city in cinema is very different. So indeed, all these spaces and these people and the people exceed these emerging cinematic representations. However, these visuals have already preserved them as memories and marked these spaces as moving images. To conclude, these images, stories of displacement and the diverse experience of the city, narrate the social history of Cochin in relation to broader changes such as development policies of the newly developed, newly independent nation, its failures, its liberalization policies, and its consequences on the city and its people. Some of these questions have already been discussed in relation to Indian cities. However, the focus of this work is to foreground a geographical perspective by using diverse sources ranging from archives to ethnography and cinema through a critical cultural studies lens to capture the affective dimensions of city structures and its people. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Carmel Christie, for that very nice presentation about different narratives of Kochi across time. I think very